Hello everyone, welcome or welcome back to my channel. If this is your first time, let me introduce myself. I'm Aishwarya and in this YouTube channel, I'll be posting videos on medical lectures, health tips and many more topics. Make sure you subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell. In this today's lecture, we are going to study about factors necessary for erythropoiesis. This video is a continuation of a topic which I have uploaded earlier. I have uploaded a video on erythropoiesis, stages of erythropoiesis. I'll link it in the description box. You can go and check it over there. Whereas in this video, we will be just dealing with the factors necessary for erythropoiesis. Let's begin. Factors necessary for erythropoiesis. Now, development and maturation requires variety of factors such as general factors, maturation factors and factors necessary for hemoglobin formation. Whenever there is formation of RBC taking place, it needs a lot of factors or important things to help it or aid it in the synthesis or production of erythrocytes. Now, let's understand these in detail. We come to the general factors. The general factors are erythropoietin, thyroxin, hemopoietic growth factors, vitamins. Let's understand this in detail. Erythropoietin. Now the most important general factor for erythropoiesis is the hormone erythropoietin, also called hemopoietin or erythrocyte stimulating factor. This erythropoietin is a glycoprotein. This is secreted by the peritubular capillaries of kidney. It is secreted by kidney. And hypoxia is one of the stimulant for secretion of erythropoietin. Now actions. How does this erythropoietin actually act? It causes formation and release of new RBCs into circulation. The formation and release of the new RBCs is the main function of erythropoietin. After secretion, it takes 4 to 5 days to show action. So after around 4 to 5 days of stimulation, it acts on the and brings about its action. Now it also promotes in production of proerythroblasts from the stem cells. From the main stem cells, the production of these proerythroblasts, these are the immature erythrocytes, so they help in the production of proerythroblasts. And not just only the production, also the development of the proerythroblast. So this was all about the erythropoietin. Next one, the next general factor is the thyroxin. Now this thyroxin, we all know it is the thyroid hormone. It is a general metabolic hormone which accelerates the process of erythropoiesis. Now this thyroxin hormone, as you can see, whenever there is hyperthyroidism, usually in hyperthyroidism we see polycythemia because its action, it accelerates the production. So whenever there is more thyroxin, that will lead to production of more RBCs. I hope you got the point. The third general factor here is the hemopoietic growth factor. Now these are nothing but the interleukins and the stem cell factors. The interleukins, these induce proliferation of the pluripotent stem cell. If you remember, these pluripotent stem cell, these are nothing but the main cell from which the erythrocytes come out. Next is the interleukins. Interleukins which are involved in this process are interleukin 3, which is secreted by the T cell, interleukin 6, which is again secreted by T cell, endothelial cells, macrophages, and interleukin 11, which is secreted by the osteoblast. Now the fourth factor which we come across are the vitamins. Obviously, the vitamins are very important in the process of erythropoiesis. Some vitamins are also necessary for the process of erythropoiesis. Now the deficiency of these vitamins cause anemia. So if there is vitamin B deficiency, it will lead to anemia and pellagra and many other. So the main reason here is anemia. Vitamin B deficiency, vitamin C deficiency, D deficiency and E deficiency are all the reasons for the anemia. Mainly for maturation, we need vitamin B12, intrinsic factor of Castle and folic acid. The first one, that is the vitamin B12 deficiency, it is necessary for maturation of factor. It is one of the main factor for maturation of the erythrocytes. Now, it is essential for maturation of erythrocytes. Now, what is the main action? It is essential for synthesis of DNA. Don't forget this, it is an important point. Now, if there is deficiency of this vitamin B12, it leads to failure in maturation of cell and reduction in the cell division. So, because of that, the maturation process of the erythrocyte declines if there is no vitamin B12. The second important factor is the intrinsic factor of Castle. Now, this is produced by the gastric mucosa, which is essential for absorption of B12 from intestines into the blood. Now, this intrinsic factor of Castle, it is one of the important thing for, like, which is really important for absorption of vitamin B12. If vitamin B12 is not absorbed into the body, then that will lead to immaturation. Next, we come to the folic acid. Now, even this is necessary for the maturation of the erythrocytes. Now, factors necessary for hemoglobin formation. Various materials are essential for formation of hemoglobin in RBC. Deficiency of any of these substances, the listed here, will decrease the production of hemoglobin, which will again lead to anemia. The factors necessary for hemoglobin formation are here as follows. First class proteins and amino acids. Next is iron. This is necessary for formation of the heme part. For the formation of heme part, iron is very required. Copper. Now for absorption of iron from GIT, copper is required. Cobalt and nickel. Utilization of this iron is mostly done whenever cobalt and nickel are present. And obviously the vitamins, vitamin C, riboflavin, nicotinic acid, these all vitamins are necessary for the hemoglobin formation. Thank you for watching the video. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to comment and let me know. It really encourages me a lot. Thank you for watching the video.